So, as you guys probably know, this is the first week of President Donald Trump, and one of the things that he promised during his campaign was to repeal the Affordable Care Act. So, one of the things that we've been talking about and thinking about is birth control and what the Affordable Care Act covers in terms of birth control and what that will mean going forward. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I think we've talked a little bit about, at least between you and I, kind of the different forms of long-term birth control, and so I think that's probably a good place to start for, you know, if you're looking for birth control, what could, you know, if you're afraid of losing your health insurance or, you know, whatever your situation is, you know, what kind of, what options are there for women for long-term care?
Yeah, if you want birth control that's going to last, say, longer than a month or a day.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I guess our first question will be, have you heard people coming into your office asking you about what kind of long-term birth control options they have, if they might lose their health insurance or they're concerned about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think what I would say is, first of all, we have had a lot of patients concerned about this issue, specifically because for a lot of women, the Affordable Care Act really did provide a contraceptive benefit. And so we have seen many women coming in, even women with existing long-acting contraceptive, like the IUDs, come in and say, if mine expires during 4 years, what am I going to do then?
Right.
So it's a good question to ask. We've definitely seen a lot of women coming in to have IUDs placed since the election occurred, because women are looking for ultimately safe and reversible long-acting contraception.
So how long can an IUD last?
Yeah, so there's a few on the market. Currently, we have the Paragard intrauterine device, which is also known as the copper IUD. That can be in place for 10 years. The Mirena IUD, which can be in place for 5 years. There is the Skyla IUD. I always call them sisters because they're made by the same company. Mm-hmm. That one can be in place for 3 years. There's also a new one coming this year called Kylena. Mm-hmm. That is also a 5-year device and made by the same company as Mirena Skyla. And then there's the Lyletta IUD, which is also a 3-year device. Mm-hmm. So longest acting is 10 years, shortest is 3.
So that 10-year one, does that have no hormones?
Yeah, so the difference between the 10-year and the 5-year would be the 10-year, because it's copper, it has no hormone at all. And so basically when it is inside the uterus, the copper acts as kind of a sterile environment where if the sperm penetrates the cervix and gets to the uterus, that copper makes kind of an inflammatory reaction that is not dangerous in any way, but is not a good environment for sperm. Mm-hmm. And so it prevents contraception that way, or excuse me, conception that way, different from the hormonal IUDs. Mm-hmm. So Mirena, Lyletta, Skyla, and the new Kylena all have a small amount of hormone on them, slightly different than Paragard.
So what does the hormone do in terms of, what does it do?
Yeah, so the hormone is similar in all of those options. It's a progesterone derivative. So a lot of women will say, okay, there's estrogen and progestin. Mm-hmm. When you take a birth control pill, most of them have both estrogen and progestin. The IUD only has progesterone. Mm-hmm. And the makers of the IUD, the reason why they put that there, twofold. One is it actually makes the lining of the uterus much thinner. And so it is not only contraception, but it also can be helpful for women to control heavy periods. With the Paragard IUD, periods tend to be slightly heavier, maybe longer, just because of the absence of that hormone.
Okay.
So it's levonorgestrel is the name of the progesterone that's on that IUD.
Okay.
And you mentioned briefly, like, kind of can control periods and stuff like that. I mean, what other types of, besides like birth control, you know, what else are IUDs good for, I guess?
Yeah, so truly on label, the thing that they're approved for is contraception.
Mm-hmm.
Mirena has the approval by the FDA to prevent heavy bleeding. So you can use it in a woman who maybe has had a tubal ligation, permanent sterilization, but they're still having heavy periods.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only FDA approved use.
Mm-hmm.
We are using the IUD in some women who maybe have precancer of the uterus or even cancer that are maybe not surgical candidates.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's considered an off-label use, meaning not necessarily approved but accepted generally, because it may be a safer option.
Okay. So I guess we should talk about how does an IUD what is an IUD? Yeah. You know, if you're watching, what is it even? I guess there's probably some people that don't know.
Yeah, definitely. So IUD stands for intrauterine device. Basically that of device that lives in the uterus in the exact locations where a pregnancy would grow. And in effect, because of its presence, it prevents pregnancy.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
I'll say, what's the rate of, because people always talk about like the pill versus the NuvaRing versus, I mean, there's so many different forms. Yeah. How effective is the IUD?
Yeah, so 99.8% effectiveness. And that's pretty much generally across the board of all of those. So you have less than a 0.2% of a failure, which is, the failure would be an unintended pregnancy. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get pregnant. I'm using this device. Mm-hmm. 99.8% of the time it works well.
So, like, compared to, say, like, just regular birth control pills, what is the rate of that?
So the failure rate for a birth control pill with perfect use, that means I'm taking my pill same day, every time, not ever missing, is roughly about 95%.
Okay.
If you miss one or more pills throughout the month, that really drops to an 8% failure rate for a birth control compared to a 0.2% perfect use. IUD.
And then if, you know, like you've no health insurance whatsoever and you're just like using condoms or any other methods, what is that rate?
So if you, and then again, it goes back to perfect use. If you use a condom, perfect use, meaning every time, same with, you know, with the pill, they do get into the high 90s. So you're talking about 98%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 97, 98.
Yeah, but that's most perfect, that's perfect use. And perfect use is like, not just putting it on, it's putting it on right. No.
Putting it on right, putting it on before there's any contact with genitalias.
Oh.
Yes. So perfect use can be sometimes difficult to achieve.
Uh-huh. Cool.
Yeah.
So we did a slight poll in this area, and there's like, how many women here?
There's
five.
Five of us.
And only one of us doesn't have an IUD. So it seems like something that a lot of people are deciding to do. I guess the question I have, one of the reasons I don't have one, is I've heard it hurts really badly. How badly does it hurt?
On like a 1 to 10 scale?
Yeah.
It's like a solid, I don't know, 8.5.
And do you feel like that hurt happened, like it was uncomfortable when you had it inserted, and did it last for a period of time, or was it really just that appointment time?
The insertion.
Yeah.
And then the removal was also
uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable. But that's like a lot less uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's really, it's not great, but it's short.
Yes.
It's short.
So it's not like a prolonged.
No, it's like.
Agony.
No, it's like maybe, well, it feels like forever, but it's probably only like 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, we're talking, like, the pain is obviously a big part of it. Are you seeing a lot of women coming in and asking or inquiring? I mean, what's, compared to, let's say, pre-election, what kind of numbers are you having people asking about IUDs compared to now?
I mean, I think that's kind of hard for me to guesstimate, but I would say to you, it's a large percentage of women have really asked about long-term contraception and IUDs in particular, just because they're so, women talk about them now, and, you know, they're advertised. But I would say, getting back to, you know, kind of the pain, I think the most important thing is when you are talking to your provider about the potential of getting an IUD, really having them give you a realistic idea of that appointment, because I feel like a lot of my patients will be so worried about pain, and then when I have them come in to the clinic to put in their IUD, we've already talked about their expectations about how we're going to manage pain control on the forefront, and I really tell them, I tell them think about this as a short-term inconvenience and, you know, maybe uncomfortableness and even pain for such a long-term benefit. And so if you work with your provider to say, okay, I'm going to be prepared for my insertion that day, I think that's really the key. I really do. I don't think we can ever take away the pain.
No.
Yeah.
But there are definitely, you know, just using some, you know, just some real kind of realistic things, like coming in prepared, making sure that you maybe take ibuprofen or, you know, over-the-counter pain reliever about an hour before you come in. A lot of providers, myself included, like to insert IUDs when women are actually on their periods, which sounds kind of messy and kind of gross, but it's really not, and it actually is an advantage because the cervix slightly opens when women are on their period, and so it makes it a little bit easier and a lot more comfortable for women having it inserted.
So basically what you're doing is inserting it through the cervix.
Correct.
So if you're not on your period, then you have to open the cervix.
Slightly.
Which is the pain, where the pain comes from. Do people get them like after they have children or?
Yeah, so you can, an IUD can be used postpartum. Mm-hmm. And so some practitioners will actually put it in on the labor and delivery floor after a vaginal delivery. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's typically done about 6 to 10 weeks postpartum. So when you come in for your postpartum check.
Cool. Yeah. If you're just joining us, I should say, we are here with Dr. Amy Mulcaster from the Portland Clinic, and we are talking about IUDs, just pretty much anything you want to know about IUDs. If you have questions, put them in the comments. Are there any questions?
We haven't gotten a ton of questions yet, but one thing that
anyone can ask questions.
I have an IUD, and a lot of my friends do too, and I've heard anecdotally that for women who have had a child, mm-hmm. it's a lot less painful. Mm-hmm. Have you seen that? Have you gotten that feedback?
Yeah, I mean, I think pain is always subjective, right? So you never know how someone's going to respond, regardless if they've had a baby or not. But I think the truth to that really relies in the fact that if you've had a labor and the cervix has been dilated before, it usually is slightly opened or dilated, and so that makes it easier for a provider to insert. So I think there's definitely some truth to that. Mm-hmm. But I've also seen women who have had babies have a significant amount of pain, which I think gets back to everybody kind of processes things differently.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
So are there any sort of side effects or like possible, I mean, I guess there's possible beneficial and negative side effects.
Yeah.
Is there any like negative side effects we could start with?
I think so. So let's just, I'm going to divide it into two categories. So that let's put the Paragard IUD into one.
Okay.
That's the copper one.
The copper IUD, yeah. And then the hormonal ones, the Mirena, the Skyla, and the mm-hmm. Lyletta in the other category, because mm-hmm. I think the side effects are different.
Okay.
So the hormone-containing IUDs, the Mirena, the Skyla, Lyletta, they really do, the first thing that happens when an IUD gets inserted with a progesterone hormone on it, it really acts to start sloughing off the lining of the uterus. So the first side effect of most women, besides having cramping kind of on mm-hmm. and off for a couple mm-hmm. weeks, is going to be sporadic or irregular bleeding. Mm-hmm. So all of the tissue that's on the uterus, the lining of the uterus, will start to slough off, and we see that as blood.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually not that nice, compact, 5 to 7 day period kind mm-hmm. of sloughing.
Yeah. Mine was like weeks.
Correct. Oh. It's weeks, and it's annoying, and it's, yes, so I always tell...
Is this ever going to end?
Correct.
Well, yeah, I've definitely heard that.
So. Yes, so mm-hmm. I tell women, give it 12 weeks, really, in honesty.
Whoa.
12 weeks, carry something with you, expect it. You may have days where you have nothing, and you may have days where, you need a panty liner or maybe even a tampon. So that's the number one side effect, if you will. Intermittent cramping, so once in a while you'll feel cramps as the uterus kind of gets accustomed to something being there.
Okay.
So I think those are the two things that are in the forefront as far as side effects go.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at, women are always asking, well, does it cause headache? Does it cause weight gain? It's very hard to validate that in controlled trials.
Uh-huh.
And so that's not something I see a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But some women do feel like that is a problem, headaches. And I've also heard acne for Mirena IUD. I think a lot of that is a lot of women who switch to an IUD from a contraceptive pill. Contraceptive pills, birth control pills, actually help acne.
Mm-hmm.
If you take that away and you switch to a different option of contraception,
yeah.
some of that acne is going to come back naturally.
Right.
So it can be a source of frustration for a lot of women.
Because there's from what I've heard, there's less hormone.
Way less hormone. Way less.
So people who have like issues with, one of the reasons I've never taken hormonal contraception is because I don't want to deal with the hormone.
Yeah.
So for women who are interested in something that's less hormonal, I mean, I guess there's even the copper one.
Right, and so the copper one would be an option if you said, I really don't want to mess with hormones. I do want a long-acting contraception.
Mm-hmm.
With a Paragard, because there's no hormone, there's no manipulation of mm-hmm. your own ovarian hormones. However, like I was getting to before, heavier bleeding, so heavier mm-hmm. periods sometimes are a problem. A lot more cramping for some women, not all, but I think that's one of the disadvantages of the copper IUD.
I know like in like the olden days in the first IUDs there was some real serious side effects like infertility.
Correct.
Is that completely a thing of the past.
Yeah, it really is. And I so in the 1970s, there was a IUD produced that the filaments, the strings that the IUD was actually attached to, were susceptible to bacteria and bacteria kind of overgrowth. And so it was infecting uteruses, causing scarring, damage, and subsequent infertility. That was identified. That was taken off the market.
Okay.
But then IUDs kind of got a bad rap in the 1970s and the early 80s because of all that kind of damage and, you know, that was associated with that specific IUD. But the IUDs we have on the market now are definitely different than that and much more reliable and safe. And there's really no impact on fertility at all.
That's good. I always wonder this. I mean, like, I have the Mirena, and that's good for 5 years.
Yeah.
How does that work? You know, because, like, in my mind, it's like you put it in, and then in the beginning, it's like a ton of hormones, and then, like, as the years go on, it kind of tapers off. I mean, how is the dosage working?
Yeah, so the hormones are loaded onto that IUD, and you're right, as time goes by, it gets lower and lower and lower, but it doesn't decrease the effectiveness. The hormone at the end of the 5 years is just as effective, and the IUD is just as effective as it was at the first insertion at the beginning of 5 years. And so as it gets lower, what we do see, though, is a lot of women in maybe year four or year five starting to say, oh, I'm having more menstrual cycles, because a lot of women actually stop having their period because of the hormone on the IUD. So you might see a return to that. The hormone does decrease in concentration, so you'll see maybe a little more spotting, a little more kind of going back to maybe a normal cycle. But it's enough to keep the lining of the uterus thin and also to thicken the cervical mucus so that sperm have a hard time penetrating the uterus, which is really truly how the IUDs that have hormones work to prevent pregnancy. That's the biggest kind of mechanism of action.
We are starting to get some questions.
Yeah.
One of the questions that we got was, can Mirena be left in longer than 5 years? And it sounds like...
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. I get it all the time. The situation is this. The Mirena is approved by the FDA for 5 years of use. I always advise patients we shouldn't go any longer than that, because if something were to happen or it didn't work as it was intended, it would be a bad situation. So we truly do only recommend it is in place for 5 years.
And do you have to go into the doctor to get it taken out as well?
Yes. So you should have it removed by a provider. And the advantage to that is if you do want to keep going, let's say you like the 5 years and you want to, you know, you need more years of contraception, you can have one removed and replaced at the very same appointment.
Is there, just like a technical question, is there like a string that's hanging down? Or like, what is the...
I wish I would have brought one.
I know. I was like, we need like a picture and
So if you think about the IUD, it's roughly about this big. It looks like a T, the letter T. And on the bottom of the vertical, there's a small area for a string that's attached. And I always tell women it's not necessarily like a tampon string. Mm-hmm. It feels like a fishing wire almost. There's two of them. And they're really there so that, well, two reasons. One, we can remove it. So the removal is, you know, a woman goes into her provider's. It's this kind of, you're in the same position you do for a pap smear, right? Speculum goes into the vagina, and your provider will be able to see those strings. We use a small instrument really just to clamp the strings and gently pull. The other purpose of the strings is so women can self-check their IUD. Okay. So, you know, that's important, too.
To know that it's there.
To know that it's there.
When I first got it, I was like, I was checking every day. I was like, is it still in there? Because I feel like I heard stories about, or, you know, I don't know if it's true or not, of women's bodies rejecting them.
Yeah.
And then I was just afraid of...
Yeah.
Because I had, I mean, in my head, I went back to him like, that was really painful. I'd like to not have to do that again for several years.
Exactly.
Like, let me make sure it's still there.
Right. Yeah, I would say, so we talked a little bit about side effects and about the IUD and how it works, but there definitely are complications associated with the IUD, and one of them is actually uterine rejection. So my uterus doesn't like it. It will contract and push the IUD out. So if you think about the uterus as a pear and the IUD sitting in the round body of the pear, if a uterus contracts, it can actually kind of shove that IUD down towards the cervix. And that's called, you know, kind of what you're getting to, like an expulsion, we call it. The uterus is going to push it out. And so your provider will be able to see, just by doing an exam, if they can see the tip of the IUD and not just the string, then obviously that's a red flag and it needs to be removed. The other way is to get an ultrasound.
Okay.
And a lot of providers do in the office like I do at the Portland Clinic, you can ultrasound and you can see where the IUD is in the uterus to be reassured, because some women have a hard time finding that string. And so I always tell patients, if you can't feel your string, that's what we're here for. Come on in, we'll take a look, we'll reassure you that your method is there so that you're not worrying and wondering.
And is that like, I mean, that rejection, is that to like hormonal? Is that like a whole subset or is it kind of just
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I think it is kind of case by case. I mean, there are some women, for some reason, they have looks like a great shaped uterus for an IUD, and then they come in, you know, a month later and you see this little plastic piece where it shouldn't be. And I don't know if we can necessarily always figure out why, you know? So it's hard to answer. I think it's case by case.
We did get a question on Facebook about the risk of, if it's rejected or not placed properly, the risk of perforation or other damage.
Absolutely. So that's the other risk, is uterine perforation. So the IUD should sit nicely in the uterine cavity, but there are cases in which the uterus can, what I say is, poke a hole in the uterus and be floating around in your belly. We call that uterine perforation. It's pretty rare. So I would say less than 2% of the time a woman would have a problem like an expulsion or like a perforation. But unfortunately, if it does perforate the uterus, it does have to be surgically removed. So we have to go in with a camera and actually find it and remove it that way. And then also, if the IUD is not in the uterus, it's not protecting against pregnancy. And so there is a really big risk of, you know, having a pregnancy unintended when the IUD is not working where it's supposed to be.
Would you have an idea if that happened to you?
Yeah, and I think this, I tell women all the time, you're going to be checking your string, hopefully, and learning how to identify that, yes, it's still in the uterus. And I think, too, women should be coming in at least once a year for a provider to actually see the string and make sure that it's okay. And then I always tell women, you know, a lot of women after that kind of initial 12-week, you know, getting used to it with your regular bleeding and the cramping, most women will fall into a pattern. Either my period's really light every month, or I don't have my period every month. And if something differs from that pattern, if you have a really heavy, you know, month of bleeding, or you have pelvic pain or cramping, that's a red flag and you need to go see your provider. And I think a lot of that helps women to kind of identify, is this really in the right spot or not? And I think that's the best way to determine that, is to go in and have someone check it.
So another question that we got on Facebook, if the strings become detached or are not present for some reason and you want the IUD removed, what's that process like?
I have never actually seen a case where they come detached, although what you can have happen is the IUD strings can actually kind of curl into the cervix. So if you were to go check your string, you wouldn't be able to feel it. If you go into your provider and they can't see the strings, typically we can do one of two things. I usually will pull out an ultrasound machine, take a look, and use a small instrument to kind of go into the cervix, try to find the string blindly, and pull it out. Almost all the time we can do that, especially with the aid of an ultrasound machine. It's pretty easy to do. However, if your provider doesn't have an ultrasound or they really can't find it by doing something simple, there is a camera called a hysteroscope. It's about the diameter of an ink pen. It can go directly into the cervix, and you can actually see on a monitor hooked to the camera where that IUD is and where the string is. So that's a possibility as well.
So again, if you're just joining us, we're here with Dr. Amy Mulcaster from the Portland Clinic. I'm Lizzy Acker.
I'm Samantha Bakall.
And we're talking about IUDs and how you might be interested in getting them. A lot of people have been talking about IUDs. Seems like every woman in this general vicinity has one except for me. I once tried to get an IUD and I couldn't, they wouldn't insert it because they had said I had unprotected sex too recently. I was younger, as a child. But is that a concern? Like, if you're going in to get an IUD, what should you know before you go?
Yeah, I mean, I think the question is if you have unprotected sex in shortly before your procedure, there's always a risk of, okay, are you early pregnant? Certainly you don't want to put an IUD in anybody that's possibly early pregnant. So that might, the timing might just be the factor. So if you don't have any form of contraception, protected sex is a good idea leading up to your appointment. We at the Portland Clinic do a pregnancy test for every woman coming in. And so that's a good kind of way to check off and make sure that that's not going to be a problem. And then the and the second thing is you know, if you are having unprotected sex, are you at risk for maybe like gonorrhea, chlamydia, sexually transmitted disease? if you have something like that, it doesn't mean you can't have an IUD, but it's nice to recognize it beforehand because that can also cause symptoms of pain and discharge.
Okay.
So if you're not sure, you know, if something like that happened and you weren't really sure and then you have an IUD inserted, it might be hard to figure out what's really causing my symptoms.
Yeah.
And so we don't really require doing any kind of STD testing beforehand, but it may be a good idea if you've had unprotected sex to be tested before an IUD just to be sure that everything is kind of baseline before you proceed.
We've talked a little bit, well, I don't know if we actually have, but one of the reasons that we decided to talk about this now is that the Affordable Care Act does have some provisions that say your health insurer, everyone has to have health insurance, and health insurers have to cover birth control with no copay, and so there is, it seems like, a slight exemption for IUDs, but they are still covered a lot. So do you want to talk a little bit about how IUDs are currently covered?
Yeah, I can. And I think it's really, it depends on your insurer. And so I always recommend to women checking with your insurer before you come in to have an IUD inserted. You don't want to end up with a big bill that you were not expecting. Mm-hmm. With the Affordable Care Act, contraception is covered for all women, but an IUD is in the kind of medical device category. Mm-hmm. So there's kind of some semantics there.
Mm-hmm.
I would say the majority of insurers are covering IUDs 100%, but that's just, you know, that's not everyone.
Right.
So the best thing to do is to contact your insurer, make sure they're aware that it is an IUD you're going to have inserted,
mm-hmm.
so that you know right at the beginning, you know, what you're going to expect as far as are you going to have to pay out of pocket at all.
And for women who are going in for an IUD, and like their insurance is covering it, is the insurance also covering the office visit as well?
Yes.
And that's
typically
it.
It's a whole, the insertion and the IUD itself,
mm-hmm.
and actually a follow-up visit usually is all kind of like one global charge.
And for, we were talking a little bit earlier off camera, I paid for my first IUD out of pocket,
mm-hmm.
and that was basically, I had Skyla, which was the 3-year, mm-hmm. and that was $650. I mean, what, if you kind of have, you have no insurance, if you have no options, what are the kind of prices that we're looking at here?
Yeah, I think the Skyla right now is roughly $700. Mirena is about $100 more currently. Paragard traditionally was about $100 more than Mirena, but I'm not 100% sure on that, so I don't want anybody to quote me on that.
Okay.
But then typically your provider will also have an insertion fee,
mm-hmm.
And so that's tacked on to the, you know, the cost of the actual device,
mm-hmm.
And that can vary from practice to practice.
Right.
So typically I always tell women, you know, if you're getting a Mirena or even a Skyla, if you roughly $800 and then a couple hundred dollars for insertion at least, so you're talking over $1,000 if you really had to pay out of pocket.
Mm-hmm. So say you have the like 5-year IUD right now and you're concerned, you don't know if you're gonna have health insurance or whatever coming up in the next 4 years, 8 years, and you want to get a new one. Can you just take the one you have out now and get a new one, or do health insurers generally only cover like once every 3 years or once every 5 years?
Yeah, so I think that's a great question. I actually have been asked that multiple times last week.
Yeah.
And so this is what I'm telling women. If the future for us is so murky with, mm-hmm. you know, what's going to happen with the Affordable Care Act. Here's what I say. This is really just my opinion.
Okay.
If you have an IUD that's going to expire in these next 4 years, taking it out early, it's not always guaranteed it's going to be covered.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you had the insurance pay for the insertion once and it's not expired, we don't really have a medical reason to take it out.
Right.
We can't really say we're taking it out because we're not sure about what's going to happen in the future. And so I think, you know, I'm kind of telling women, I wouldn't have that expectation because it might not be covered if you take it out for, mm-hmm. you know, an unnecessary reason. We really can't justify it when the device is supposed to be in place for 3 or 5 years. So
if you want to take it out to get pregnant, you can do that. Is that covered?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Depending on plans.
Right. Okay.
But it should be. I mean, you know, you would contact your insurance company and ask them.
Okay.
And that's the thing about the IUDs too. Just because you have an IUD that's supposed to last for 5 years doesn't mean you have to keep it in. It can
mm-hmm.
be removed at any time, mm-hmm. if you're ready to start a family.
Cool. Are there any more questions?
Yes, we got a question. If there were any considerations or, you know, lack of effectiveness or heightened risks for women who are maybe a little bit heavier.
Mm-hmm.
I know with hormonal birth control,
mm-hmm.
With traditional pills, that could be an issue.
Yeah.
It's like not even that much heavier.
Yeah, I mean, there, you know, there is a device on the market called the Nexplanon. I don't know, it's an arm implant. That's another long-term. And that does have some concerns about weight. But with the IUDs, you can be rest assured that there are no weight restrictions. It doesn't matter because the uterus is unaffected by a woman's height or weight. And so it's a great form of birth control for anybody of any size, really.
So it's actually just working in, it's almost like, in some ways, a physical barrier versus like your whole body.
Yeah, I think that's one of the biggest advantages of an IUD that we talk about is that the hormone is so local inside the uterus. And if you think about the uterus, it's such a thick muscle. I mean, it's got a big job to do, right? Mm-hmm. And so the hormone concentrations on the IUD aren't really affecting your other body systems. Mm-hmm. And so that's why it can really virtually for anybody, you know, work.
Someone was asking, I don't know if it was on camera or off, but you were talking about women who get their tubes tied.
Yeah.
Is this, maybe it was Sam?
No, yeah, I had heard that somebody had said, or I read somewhere, that an IUD was more effective than surgery.
Yes, so if you look at the research done, tubal ligation, so that's, you know, we go in with a camera and we either put some kind of like rubber band or clip or cut the tubes, the failure rate of that is anywhere between 2% and 5%.
Whoa.
And if you think about it, I just told you that the failure rate is 0.2%. So yeah, wow. I mean, that's the research, that's what it shows.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know, do we have any other questions? Are there...
I guess if you're like, if we've scared you off from IUDs, what other, you know, like, well-acting long-term birth control?
Yeah, well, I want to make one point before we maybe shift to that, is I always tell women, IUDs aren't for everybody. So as much as we're like, oh, this is a great thing, and you're kind of like, oh, well, I'm the only one that doesn't have one, they're not perfect for everyone. Mm-hmm. And so there are a lot of advantages, certainly all the ones we talked about, but there are some women that don't have, you know, the shape of a uterus that may accommodate their risk for, you know, having the IUD expelled is higher. Some women may have side effects that we can't predict.
Yeah.
And so I just want to let everybody know that it's not, you know, perfect for everyone. But if it's something that you want to do, I think it's definitely worth having a conversation with your provider about your specific case, you know, what your situation is, and talk a little bit more about that.
What about age-wise? I guess that would be something like, you know, I think a lot of younger girls now go on birth control for lots of reasons, but what if you're like, do you guys have an age requirement to get an IUD?
There really isn't, and I mean, pretty much depending on a provider's comfort, you can put IUDs in younger women that are just, you know, starting out being sexually active if they choose, all the way to, you know, women who are approaching menopause. Mm-hmm. So a lot of women choose to use IUDs kind of in their 50s as they're getting towards menopause because they don't want to take a pill anymore. They've done that before.
Right.
And then some women at the beginning of, you know, having being sexually active, maybe for some reason they don't want to have the responsibility of taking a pill or being responsible for that every day. Mm-hmm. It's a really attractive option. So no age limits or ranges, really. Yeah.
Yep, I think we answered all the questions that we got on Facebook.
Yeah. I guess were there any
Do you want me to go?
Yeah, that would be great to just have an idea of what other...
Yeah, okay, so in the long-term contraception range, meaning put it in place and it stays there, there's the Nexplanon. Mm-hmm. So that is a 4-inch plastic rod. It looks like a match, almost like a matchstick. We implant it in the upper arm, so it gets injected in the upper arm. It releases its hormone every day into the bloodstream. you can actually see it in Felix. Wow. It's just under the skin. So that
futuristic.
Yeah, it's actually been on the market a while.
I know, but it seems like
But that's good for 3 years. Yeah. So that's a 3-year contraception that would also be, you know, long-term and totally low maintenance. And then you're really just back to kind of the old standbys. Mm-hmm. The birth control pill, there's the birth control patch, which you stick on your skin like a sticker and has to be replaced once a week. There is the Nuva ring, which is a ring that's, I guess, about this big. It's flexible and it goes in the vagina like a tampon. Mm-hmm. And you leave it in for 3 weeks, take it out, have a period, put a brand new one in. So it's once a month that you have to think about that. So once a week for the patch, every 3 weeks for the Nuva ring that goes in the vagina. Pill, as you guys know, is daily use. And then there's an injectable called Depo-Provera. Mm-hmm. That's one that you get a shot, just like an immunization or a vaccination, but it's a hormone shot you get in your arm every 3 months.
Okay.
So.
What if you're a male person who wants to, Is there anything besides condoms?
Unfortunately,
I don't know. I'm just asking this question as if some magical thing came up in the last, like, 10 minutes. What can dudes do?
What else? I think it's a good question. There's currently, right now, there's some clinical trials for male contraception, but nothing that's coming up right now for approval, so...
What about a vasectomy? How effective is that?
So a vasectomy, if you have a vasectomy and then you do your kind of post-operative check, it is also in the high 90s. I'm not a urologist, so I don't want to give you an actual percent, but very effective as long as you follow, you know, the... I think one of the biggest things is men forgetting to go back for their check afterwards and just making sure that there's no active swimmers. but it is very effective.
Cool. Have you had a lot of women come in recently to get them inserted? And
yes, a lot. My partner and I both have had conversations about, oh my gosh, are you doing a lot of IUDs? And yeah, we really have. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think women are concerned about having to, you know, spend money, more money on contraceptives in the next 4 years. So we've really seen a big upswing. And we really have.
I feel like we covered a lot, but are there any questions that you've been getting that we didn't touch on? Or
I think you guys have asked a lot of the basics and a lot of the really relevant ones that women are really coming in. I don't think so. I don't think there's anything else I would add to that. Other than, you know, we're always available for questions.
Yeah.
Certainly myself at the Portland Clinic. I like to meet my patients before I put in an IUD. I like them to have a visit with me first for an expectations, kind of set it out, let them know. Mm-hmm. And then we usually schedule it as a procedure. Mm-hmm. I feel like women actually tolerate it better if you can get on board with what's going to happen at my actual insertion, and you can kind of calm down the nerves and the anxiety when you do it that way.
Yeah, I had one of the nurses had to, like, kind of hold me down a little bit. It's like, I trust you, so this is okay.
Definitely. Yeah, it's nice to meet your provider first before they're actually doing something that is potentially uncomfortable and painful.
And personal.
Yes, exactly.
I'm assuming. Cool. Well, thank you again. Yeah. This is Dr. Amy Mulcaster from the Portland Clinic, and we're here from the Oregonian. And you should... You know, once this is done, you can watch the whole video again and find out all this information. This was so helpful. Yeah. I feel like I just learned about it.
Well, thanks for having me.
Thank you so much.
Yeah,
of course.
You.
Thank you. Bye.